Hello, I'm Dr. Ailey Kalapilla from Emory University. In this National HIV Curriculum mini-lecture, I will provide a summary of the antiretroviral medication darunavir, cobicistat, tenofovir alafenamide, emtricitabine. Darunavir, cobicistat, tenofovir alafenamide, emtricitabine is a fixed-dose combination single-tablet regimen made up of the four medications shown on this slide. From here onward, I will refer to this combination medication as darunavir, cobi, taf, FTC. The pill is to be taken orally once a day with food. Darunavir, cobi, taf, FTC is a single tablet that is a complete regimen for the treatment of HIV type 1 infection in adults and pediatric patients weighing at least 40 kilos. The tablet can be used as an antiretroviral regimen among these individuals who have no prior antiretroviral treatment history or who are virologically suppressed, meaning an HIV-1 RNA viral load less than 50 copies per ml, and on a stable antiretroviral regimen for at least 6 months and who have no known substitutions associated with resistance to either darunavir or tenofovir. Patients who are being prescribed darunavir, cobi, taf, FTC need to have their renal function checked prior to initiating the tablet. The reason for this is that darunavir, cobi, taf, FTC is not recommended for use in individuals with a creatinine clearance below 30 mL per minute. Hepatitis B serologies also need to be checked prior to using the drug. The TAF and FTC components of the single tablet regimen are active against hepatitis B infection. Hence, if an individual taking darunavir, cobi, TAF, FTC has chronic hepatitis B infection and they suddenly stop taking the medication, they could be at risk for severe acute exacerbation of hepatitis B, which can lead to decompensated liver disease and or liver failure. So darunavir, cobi, taf, FTC should be used with caution in individuals with HIV hepatitis B co-infection, and those patients should be warned of the risk of fulminant liver disease if they were to suddenly stop taking the medication. Finally, darunavir, cobi, taf, FTC is not recommended for use in individuals with severe hepatic impairment, specifically, Child Pugh Class C or higher chronic liver disease. Next, I am going to delve into more detail on the mechanism of action of the key drugs that make up darunavir, cobi, taf, FTC. First, let's talk about tenofovir alafenamide or TAF and emtricitabine or FTC. These belong to a class of drugs called nucleoside reverse transcriptase inhibitors. They work by blocking HIV reverse transcription. They resemble the human nucleosides in structure, but when incorporated into the elongating chain of DNA, no further nucleotides can be added. Hence, they act as chain terminators. Next, we will focus in on the drug darunavir. In order to understand the mechanism of action of darunavir, we first need to review the HIV protease enzyme. HIV protease plays a critical role late in the HIV life cycle by cleaving or chopping up HIV polypeptides, which separates and frees the individual HIV proteins. Darunavir is an HIV protease inhibitor, so it blocks the normal protein processing that HIV protease does late in the HIV life cycle. Finally, cobicistat or cobi, which is not shown on these slides, does not act on the HIV life cycle directly. It is a cytochrome P450 inhibitor which serves to increase systemic exposure of darunavir so that darunavir can be dosed once daily in combination with other antiretroviral drugs. Now we will discuss notable clinical trials studying darunavir, cobi, taf, FTC use in combination antiretroviral regimens. In antiretroviral treatment naive individuals, the AMBER study evaluated the efficacy of darunavir, cobi, taf, FTC as a single tablet regimen compared to darunavir, cobi combination pill given along with tenofovir disoproxil fumarate emtricitabine combination pill. You can see the inclusion criteria on this slide. 725 participants were enrolled and randomized in a 1-to-1 fashion to either the darunavir COBE TAF FTC arm or to the control arm. The primary objective was to demonstrate non-inferiority of darunavir COBE TAF FTC compared to the control arm with viral suppression, meaning an HIV viral load less than 50 copies per ml at 48 weeks on treatment. Results on virologic suppression indicated that at week 48, darunavir COBE TAF FTC was non-inferior to the control, with 91.4% of subjects having achieved a viral load less than 50 copies per ml in the experimental arm versus 88.4% in the control arm. Serum creatinine increased from baseline to week 48 in the darunavir COBE TAF FTC arm, which was consistent with cobicistat inhibition of creatinine tubular secretion, but this increase in serum creatinine was less compared to the control group. Consequently, the mean decrease in estimated GFR at week 48 was less for darunavir COBE TAF FTC than with the control arm. However, mean cystatin-based estimated GFR actually increased at week 48, and the increase was greater for darunavir COBE TAF FTC than control group. In general here, the bottom line was that darunavir COBE TAF FTC was associated with a better renal safety profile than control. Similarly, at week 48, all quantitative measures demonstrated less proteinuria for darunavir COBE TAF FTC versus control, as determined by mean changes from baseline in urine protein to creatinine ratio, urine albumin to creatinine ratio, retinol binding protein to creatinine ratio, and beta to microglobulin ratio. These results further underscore the renal safety advantage of administering tenofovir alafenamide in combination with darunavir COBE compared to using tenofovir disoproxil fumarate that was used in the control arm of the study. In a bone investigation sub-study, hip, lumbar spine, and femoral neck bone mineral density from baseline to week 48 were stable with darunavir COBE TAF FTC, whereas they decreased significantly at week 48 in the control group. This demonstrated more favorable hip and spine bone mineral density and hence better bone safety of darunavir COBE TAF FTC. Median increases from baseline in fasting lipids were higher for darunavir COBE TAF FTC versus control, with the increase in HDL cholesterol favoring darunavir COBE TAF FTC and remaining lipid increases favoring control. There was a small, statistically significant difference in the total cholesterol-HDL cholesterol ratio between groups. So the main conclusion of the AMBER study was that darunavir COBE TAF FTC achieved a high virologic suppression rate and was non-inferior to darunavir COBE with tenofovir disoproxil fumarate emtricitabine. Darunavir COBE TAF FTC also demonstrated the bone and renal safety advantages of TAF in combination with darunavir COBE. Next, we will review another clinical trial involving darunavir COBE TAF FTC called EMERALD, which was essentially a switch study in treatment-experienced patients. EMERALD was a Phase 3 randomized clinical trial to evaluate the efficacy of darunavir COBE TAF FTC in individuals with HIV who had a viral load less than 50 copies per ml. Study subjects needed to be virologically suppressed for at least 2 months in order to be eligible to participate in the trial. Study participants also needed to be on a stable antiretroviral regimen for at least 6 months, which consisted of a boosted protease inhibitor combined with tenofovir disoproxil fumarate emtricitabine. Subjects had no history of failure on darunavir treatment and no known or suspected darunavir resistance-associated substitutions. Study participants were either switched to the darunavir COBE TAF FTC single tablet or continued on their treatment regimen. This slide shows the baseline characteristics of the experimental arm versus the control arm of the study. And as you can see here, the baseline characteristics were comparable between the two groups. After 48 weeks on treatment, 95% of patients in the switch group and 94% in the control group had achieved virological suppression defined as an HIV viral load less than 50 copies per ml. The virologic rebound rate, which was described as a confirmed viral load greater than or equal to 50 copies per ml at any time point up to 48 weeks, was comparable between the switch arm and the control arm. 2.5% virological rebound in the switch group compared to 2.1% in the control group. Differences between the two study arms in terms of serum creatinine and estimated GFR at week 48 were not significant, although larger increases in serum creatinine and larger decreases in estimated GFR occurred in patients switching to the study regimen compared with the control regimen, and this was thought to be possibly due to the effect of cobicistat on inhibition of creatinine tubular secretion. Now, when GFR was measured with cystatin C, which is not affected by the interaction of cobicistat with creatinine secretion, there was no significant effect on estimated GFR in the study group and a small decline in the control group with results that remained within normal limits. When looking at the effect of darunavir-cobi-TAF-FTC on urinary markers of tubular dysfunction, the results demonstrated that compared with staying on the control regimen, switching to study regimen resulted in statistically significant improvements at 48 weeks in all measures of quantitative glomerular and proximal tubular proteinuria. So this slide and the previous slide indicate that the renal results were consistent with the established effects of tenofovir alafenamide, mainly the preservation of GFR and less tubular proteinuria than with the tenofovir disopyroxal fumarate. Notably, the reduction in renal tubular proteinuria seen with the switch group suggested that the study regimen of darunavir-cobi-TAF-FTC might have a lower potential for nephrotoxicity than the control regimen. In a sub-study looking at bone mineral density, the switch group had significant improvements in bone mineral density at the hip, lumbar spine, and femoral neck when compared to the control group. Changes in fasting total cholesterol and LDL cholesterol at week 48 favored the control regimen. However, these were not actually clinically relevant differences in terms of the ratio of total cholesterol to HDL cholesterol between groups. So the conclusion drawn from the EMERALD study is that in virologically suppressed treatment-experienced adults with HIV type 1 infection who switched to a single tablet regimen of darunavir-cobi-TAF-FTC, the regimen was safe, effective, and non-inferior compared with regimens of boosted protease inhibitor plus tenofovir disopyroxal fumarate. So next, we will review adverse effects. The important thing to be aware of here is that the adverse effects described are mainly the result of the darunavir component on this medication. Gastrointestinal side effects, such as nausea or diarrhea, may be seen in less than 10% of individuals taking darunavir-cobi-TAF-FTC. Now, darunavir does have a sulfonamide moiety, so individuals with a reaction such as a rash to sulfa-containing drugs may have a similar reaction to this darunavir-containing pill. Rarely, individuals may have a more severe hypersensitivity reaction, such as Stevens-Johnson syndrome. It is important to remember here that a history of a sulfonamide allergy is not a contraindication to taking darunavir. However, increased monitoring is recommended. So, in review, darunavir-cobi-TAF-FTC is a once-daily complete antiretroviral regimen that has been co-formulated into a single tablet regimen. It is a complete regimen for treatment-naive individuals or treatment-experienced individuals who have a suppressed HIV RNA level on a stable regimen for greater than or equal to 6 months and no resistance to darunavir or tenofovir. And the medication has a high genetic barrier to developing drug resistance. So this would be a potent and practical HIV treatment option for individuals who are eligible to receive the drug and for whom there is concern for poor adherence. It is a large pill that patients may find difficult to swallow. The manufacturer does not recommend crushing the tablet, but the tablet can be split into two using a pill cutter, with the entire dose being consumed immediately after the pill has been cut. The medication should not be prescribed to individuals with severe renal or hepatic impairment. In general, the medicine is well tolerated, with the most common side effects being gastrointestinal in nature. Drug interactions can occur with darunavir-CoV-TAF-FTC. They are complex, and clinicians should be aware of this and refer to the prescribing information tables or drug interaction websites to check on interactions. Finally, in summary, darunavir-CoV-TAF-FTC is a potent option for initial therapy with high genetic barrier to resistance, but often not chosen as the preferred agent due to large pill size, problematic drug interactions caused by cobicistat, and rare but potential serious side effects.
The production of this National HIV Curriculum Mini-Lecture was supported by funding from the Health Resources and Services Administration.